Hello, very warm welcome to the Daily Politics on Friday. The Brussels summit draws to a close with EU leaders hoping for the Lisbon Treaty to be finally ratified in the next week or so. In the meantime, that debate over who exactly gets to be president and effective foreign minister stays splattered on the front pages. Also today, President Obama meets his top military chiefs to talk strategy on Afghanistan. The president is still deciding whether or not to commit more troops. But is he deliberating or is he dithering? We're going to be talking to former Clinton adviser James Rubin. And when it comes to the scandal over parliamentary expenses, are the Lords really being given a much easier ride than MPs?
I think it's living in a fool's paradise to imagine that you can have a completely new overhauled regime, a clean-up, one end of the building where the MPs are, and then not do anything about the indefensible allowance system that we have in the Lords.
And I'll be telling you who's coining it and who's lost the receipt in this week's Top of the Political Pops.
And with me today, I'm delighted to say we've got for the whole programme Peter Hitchens, columnist for The Mail on Sunday, and The Guardian's parliamentary sketch writer Simon Hoggart. We are spoilt with riches today. Thank you very much for being with us. Now, all eyes are on Brussels this morning as European leaders meet for their final day of the EU summit. For fans of the European project, there is some good news. Ratification of the Lisbon Treaty moves a step closer after a deal was struck with the Czech president Václav Klaus. The Czech Republic is the only country not to have ratified this treaty, but it seems, for one pro-European at least, there may be some bad news, and I'm talking about Tony Blair here, because his hopes of becoming the first president of the European Council appear to have been dashed after he failed to get, or any, substantial backing, quite frankly. That, however, could lead the way for the Foreign Secretary David Miliband to have a bit of a go at being Europe's new High Representative for Foreign Affairs and Security, although at the moment he says he's really not interested. Well, let's go over to Brussels, where our correspondent Laura Kunzberg is following the events. First of all, Laura, I said for those who are fans of the matter, this ratification is close, but how close are we talking?
Well, Anita, certainly you're right. The mood here last night in this vast European Council complex was really that they'd achieved something by doing a deal with the Czech Republic, as you rightly say, the last country left who hasn't yet signed up to the Lisbon Treaty. They got a deal on that last night, and it should be full steam ahead, except that the Czech court still has an opportunity to rule on the treaty next week. Next Tuesday morning, they'll be making up their minds. And the Czech president, Václav Klaus, well, for now, it seems that he's happy with the deal. But you never know. He's not the most predictable character. But lots of people here late last night breathing a huge sigh of relief, thinking that after lengthy and tortuous negotiations, Lisbon now looks pretty set to become law very soon.
Yes, and what about Tony Blair? I mean, this was the most talked up anointing that I've come across in the papers for a very long time, but it looks like actually he's nowhere near.
Well, certainly, I think his chances this morning are a lot lower than they were 24 hours previously. But I also think there's a difference here. The British press have been talking about this for ages, loving, almost perhaps salivating at the prospect of this. It would be a great story, wouldn't it, if Tony Blair was anointed the new king of Europe. But here in Brussels, people I've been speaking to have always been a bit more sceptical about it. And certainly what we saw yesterday was a series of people make it quite clear that they weren't really up for the idea. And there's also talk of a deal emerging between the right-hand bloc of the European Union and the left-hand bloc. And perhaps if the right-hand bloc, the bigger group, they might be the ones who'd be allowed to choose the president. So that's the job that Tony Blair apparently covets. And that would leave the group on the left being able to choose the EU High Representative job. Now, that certainly wouldn't do much for Tony Blair's chances, but, oh, you never know, it might leave space for the Foreign Secretary, David Miliband, to come up the rear and take that other job. Not something that he's campaigning for at the moment, certainly not. Yesterday he and the Prime Minister made it quite clear that he was not available. But a few people have chatted to here say, well, stranger things have happened.
Yes, indeed. Well, thank you very much, Laura. And with us now here in Westminster, we've got the Conservative MP Mark Field. Whatever are you going to do now? The Czechs were the final frontier. So how are the Conservatives going to deal with this whole issue of ratification?
It's a fast-moving situation, Anita. I mean, 4 weeks ago, we had the Irish referendum. At that juncture, neither the Poles nor the Czechs had signed up. And I think William Hague has got it absolutely right to say it's sort of one policy at a time. And we've made it very clear we will not let matters rest. And before the likes of Peter Hitchens suggest that this is going to be a mass betrayal, remember David Cameron was good for his promise on removing the Conservatives from the EPP grouping, which many people, both within the party and outside, felt wasn't going to happen. So I think William Hague and the team on the Foreign Office crew, as it were, will be formulating whatever the next step will be once the Czech ratification has taken place.
It is always fun to preempt what Peter Hitchin is going to say, but it's more fun to hear what Peter Hitchin is going to say about this.
I'm sorry, Peter.
That's perfectly all right, but you're more or less right. This whole Conservative posture about the European Union is a posture. The Conservative Party has from the start been the most pro-European Union, before that pro-common market party in the state. And it's extremely enthusiastic for further integration, but it pretends for electoral purposes to be otherwise. But each time it's actually in office, it gets us deeper in. It got us into the Single European Act, it got us into Maastricht. Had it been in office in the past few years, it would have acceded to all the other handings over of sovereignty that have taken place. That's what the Conservative Party is. The Conservative Party has invented a political position called Euroscepticism, which can be most easily summed up as being opposed to the European Union in opposition and favour of it in government. It's completely fraudulent to try and rely on poor old Václav Klaus, a man for whom I have a great deal of admiration, as your defence and fig leaf during this season, when everybody knew that this treaty was going to be ratified, and also this pledge that you're going to have referenda over future treaties. There aren't going to be any future treaties. That's the whole point of Lisbon. It's from now on, the European Union is a legal personality. It makes its own decisions. It isn't going to need any treaties. It's an empty promise, and a symbolic one, just like the EPP.
Simon?
Nonsense.
I did wonder what about David Cameron this week, saying, well, if the treaty is ratified by the Czech Republic, then we shall have to consider that. Or, well, you know, it's not much of a battle cry, is it? Give us time to think, says Tory leader. You're not going to have a referendum for unratifying the treaty, are you? So what are you going to do? You're going to have you could have a referendum on whether we wish to stay in Europe. That would seem to me absolutely a legitimate question to ask. It would create immense damage in our relationships with Europe. But on the other hand, David Cameron seems very happy about that, which no doubt is why he's linked himself with this collection of weirdos and oddballs.
As I said, Simon, I mean, he's made it very clear on the EPP, and he's delivered on that. And I'm absolutely confident that we will have a package that we will put forward by the time of the next election, assuming that the Czech ratification goes through. And as I say, this is a fast-moving situation. There were three countries only 4 weeks ago that hadn't ratified
this. Yes, I know. It's a fast-moving situation, but it seems to be moving in this one direction. It would be an absolute stunning shock if Václav Klaus did anything else. Now, tell me, I mean, in the spirit of clarity, what are you going to write in your manifesto? What are you going to promise? Because it would seem that you're hearing from both our commentators here, and indeed we hear it from those who get in touch, the fudge isn't good enough anymore. What are people going to be allowed to say about this? You've promised so much.
We've said we would not let matters rest if we got to the stage which I think we're likely to reach.
You're not letting matters rest. Nobody really understands, Mark Field, what that means.
They don't yet. And William Hague has made it absolutely clear. We will have and formulate precisely what that will mean. And I think it's been a perfectly sensible and pragmatic approach to take, because let's face it, if 4 weeks ago the Irish had said no for the second time on the referendum, the whole thing would have fallen. So
they weren't going to say
it is moving very fast.
Resolute for drift, decisive for indecision.
Okay, well,
meaningless posing.
Let us move on. You mentioned William Hague, and I'm quite interested in what William Hague has been talking about. Now, let's move it on to the other thing that Laura was speaking of today. It would seem the apparent rise and fall of the aspirations of Tony Blair. Now, he said, Hague, this week, that it would be a hostile act to appoint Tony Blair. It's something that you agree with?
Yeah, I think that actually Tony Blair's reputation is fast diminishing. He is the Baldwin of this age, and unfortunately, unlike Stanley Baldwin, he will live long enough to see the total trashing of his reputation on the international stage and domestically. And I think the reality of the situation is that, as you say, a lot of British journalists have been talking up the idea of Tony Blair in Europe, and one has to remember there's a lot of ego and vanity there, those leaders. The last thing on earth most of the 27 heads of state would have wanted would have had someone like Tony Blair, who would look upon this as being sort of part of his international portfolio.
Well, Simon Hoggart, there was an interesting thing in the Times today that I read that said they were suggesting that perhaps this was a diplomatic effort to go and talk the whole situation down, because nobody likes somebody somebody crowing and flying that high, and this way actually it improves his chances somehow.
I don't think he's going to get it. No, only if Merkel and Sarkozy don't want him. His total supporters now are Gordon Brown, who won't be here in 6 months, and Berlusconi, whose reputation is perhaps not at its peak at the moment. So I think he's had it. And it's quite interesting, too, that David Cameron, who we assume will be our Prime Minister in 6 months' time, was very, very dismissive of him a day or so ago. And, of course, oddly enough, the reason Cameron was giving was he'd be too good. He would be Mr. Europe around the world, this rather glamorous, famous... And I think maybe you're right, Mark, about his reputation being crushed, but it hasn't been crushed yet. And to a lot of people, unlike the European bureaucrat mountain from which I suspect some wretched unknown person will be plucked...
But, I mean, an interesting side effect might be, OK, not Blair, but Miliband. Miliband is much more an appetising concept for the likes of Merkel, for the likes of Sarkozy.
I'm just not interested in what this foreign body, who this foreign body wants to appoint to run its alien policies. I don't care. I simply want to run our own country to run itself.
But as you said yourself, Peter, it's a foregone conclusion.
If the Tory party is so unenthusiastic about Mr. Blair, why did your leader actually lead a standing ovation for him when he left office? Why, for a very long time, was the impression strongly given by the Conservative Party that they supported Mr. Blair's candidacy, as far as I can see, and certainly weren't opposing it? It's all jostling now. You are and believe yourselves to be the heirs to Blair. You are the continuation of Blairism by other means. Why you should be against him for political reasons, I have no idea, since you're indistinguishable.
OK, let's just move to Miliband, the question of Miliband. Would the Conservatives back David Miliband?
I think you better ask William Hague.
I'm asking you. You're here at the moment. I mean, you know, if you've had a history lesson of the position when it came to Blair. Now, we'd like to know what the future might be, because Miliband is looking more and more an attractive prospect over
there. I personally would find David
Miliband
a more palatable prospect. For the reasons that I've made it pretty clear why I don't think Tony Blair is the right man. I think one assumes...
We make it clear we're not talking about for the same position. We're talking about this de facto foreign secretary
And one assumes that part and parcel of that would be Miliband leaving British politics to do this as a full-time role and would then be a British voice within the European Union. But I think, I think that potentially is much more palatable to many in Europe as well.
Well, he wouldn't be, though, would he? Because the whole point about being a European Union... functionary is that you actually sign a declaration that you will serve the European Union and not your own country. That's the purpose of it.
Right, and just very briefly, we're running out of time on this. We could talk about it for a very long time. Michael Heseltine's comments this week that now the Conservatives have to unpick policy, especially when it comes to this grouping that they find themselves in. I mean, he's a powerful voice, and that's a powerful message that he's delivering.
Well, there's several messages here, and we've got the new grouping in place, and as I say, it is a pretty fluid situation in both the European Parliament and in Europe as a whole. But I think that the grouping is working pretty well. We're making some important cases for example, the power of the City
but
of London
in relation situation,
to
unpicking it is not out of the question.
And private equity.
Out of the question.
I mean, in essence, the policy we have had has been that we have wanted to have a referendum on the Lisbon Treaty. If that treaty is entirely ratified by all 27 nations, we then have said we will not let matters rest. So there will be a new set of policies going forward. I know that everyone would like to have some sort of grand plan that means we know where we're going to be in the next 10 or 15...
Listen, we're
living in a very different world to the one we were living in two years ago, when most commentators were saying that we had a low inflation economy, it was all going to be tremendous and wonderful, and the financial services world was into the uplifts ahead. So,
okay.
You know, we're in a very, very different world.
All right, OK.
Absolutely.
On that note, thank you very much, Mark Field, for being with us.
Thanks, Anita.
There isn't really a lot we haven't said about MPs and their expenses. We've been banging on about it for the past few months. But what about those people who sit in the other house? The Lords don't get paid for the work that they do, but they can claim allowances, tens of thousands of pounds a year. And you know what? They don't even need receipts to back these claims. Now, a report due out in the coming weeks is likely to recommend cuts to those allowances. But is that report going to go far enough? Colette Macbeth reports.
Now here's a story. Let's call it the tale of two houses. And what's gone on behind these doors has kept us intrigued, shocked, even outraged for many a month. And so in future, it's going to be very different behind this door.
Yes, in this house, don't we know it, it's all change. At the moment, MPs can claim mortgage interest on their London home. They can also get a subsistence allowance for food and travel, and they can employ their spouses. But soon, that could all go.
Oh, and another thing, many of them have been asked to pay back money. It's for that reason that until now, some at least have been saying that behind the door of the other house, they've been having an easier ride, but maybe not for much longer.
Yes, it looks like this system could be changing too. At the moment, peers get a day's subsistence help with things like secretarial and travel costs and an accommodation allowance should they need it. And those could be cut back. But most importantly, they could soon have to provide, for the very first time, these receipts to back their claims.
Ah, the receipts, or the current lack of them, mean it's unlikely the Lords' claims will be audited like MPs' expenses have been. But since most of the allegations against them centre around designating a main home outside the capital to claim an overnight accommodation allowance, this man says it can be done.
They have to declare a main house, and you can go and find out, is that their main home? Who owns that home? Is it a home that they've stayed at? As with one of the peers, we found that the peer had not been there for 3-4 years and had never visited and never been seen. So I think if there's a will, there's a way.
In fact, there are six lords under investigation: Lord Paul, Lord Sheldon, Lord Bartier, while Lord Taylor of Warwick, Lord Clark and Baroness Udin are believed to be the three that the police are investigating separately. But there is another problem with those investigations. In the Lords, there is currently no definition of what a main residence actually is. David Cameron said this week that every peer will now be asked to identify it clearly.
One of the concerns I've had is that we haven't had the knowledge and the information at our fingertips. Well, we now will, and partly to protect members of the House of Lords who are doing absolutely nothing wrong.
Another peer says he wants to see big changes in the House of Lords.
It needs to be properly audited. Those who have particular expenses should be able to show what those expenses are. And in particular, people who work every day of the week here, from the front benches of the three parties and the cross benches, I think should be enabled to do the job properly.
Lord Tyler says it's time to pay our peers properly and tax them. Will that happen? Well, the Senior Salaries Review Body is looking into the Lords' allowances. We'll report back in November.
So with us now to discuss all of this, we've got the Labour peer, Lord Desai. It is true, isn't it? Absolutely true that the peers have got away very, very lightly here. When you see what's going on in the other chamber, they must be, well, some may say, actually laughing.
Yeah. Two things. Our expense allowances are derisory compared to what the Commons get, firstly. And I have certainly said to the Senior Salaries Review Board when they came, that we should make them not expenses, but a fee for attendance and make them taxable. So we don't have this myth that we have subsistence expenses and office expenses. This is the cost of attending the House of Lords, because if I'm not there, I could be doing something else.
Sure, but you know that there are those who are really struggling at the moment in this financial climate, who really don't understand why subsistence or charging for lunch or any of those things are acceptable. And what they'll be asking is, hang on a minute, I don't just want you to change things in the future. If MPs have had to be looked at by an independent scrutiny body and it has been retrospective, why not you lot?
Fine. I have no problem with that.
But it's not going to happen, is it?
No, it is going to happen. I think we no longer can say that these are honourable men and women and therefore we should trust them. That era is over. Okay? That I know. Now, what we need to do is to make it transparent, and we need to make it uncluttered, because these receipts and things like that, the whole MP's problem has been caused by the fact that you could submit the receipts for anything.
Yes, I mean,
and you can get paid.
In a way, as you say, I mean, these are very small amounts compared when you compare them to what's been claimed by MPs. But then there is the other issue, isn't it? As you say, these are supposedly honourable people who at times have been claiming money to affect legislation. Yeah. And that, I mean, the Lord Eames recommendations yesterday. I mean, it beggars belief that you have to now remind members of the House of Lords that they have to behave honourably. That's one of his recommendations.
Well, they've got all kinds of riffraff in the House of Lords these days, you know. I sort of remember the time when it was landed gentry who had a bit of money. No, I mean, the problem, I think we're in danger of losing the particular skill and ability of the House of Lords, which has been to bugger around with government legislation. And they've done a pretty splendid job under this government, and let's not forget, under the Thatcher and Major governments as well. And, OK, when we have an elected House of Lords with full salaries, paying taxes, PAYE, and having to put in a piece of paper for everything they spend, that'll be fine in many ways. It'll certainly be more democratic. I doubt if it will do anything like as good a job as the present House of Lords has done. And let's not let that particular baby go out of the window with the bathwater.
Peter, you're nodding your head.
Well, I think that's true. I regret very much that we cast aside so lightly the idea that people should be trusted to behave honourably. I think a society in which you could trust people to behave honourably is better than one where you say, oh, well, that's impossible, we can't expect it to happen. And I think just to say, oh, well, that's gone, without a passing backward glance or any serious sign of regret or any wondering why it's gone, is a bad thing in itself. I also think there is a law of unintended consequences in operation here. All these frenzies against MPs' expenses are actually going to end up with more government and executive control of both houses of parliament, which nobody will want when it's happened. And I think we should be very careful not to get too carried away.
And just finally, should there be new powers to actually boot some peers out if they have been deemed to have behaved in a really unacceptable way? Because at the moment you can't. I mean, you're suspended, but then you come back.
Well, but if somebody has acted illegally, we don't yet have the power to deny somebody who's gone to prison the right not to re-enter. Mm. But the government is going to pass legislation about that if they want to. I mean, okay.
Well, thank you very much for being with us, Lord Desai. Now, let's move on to the question of Afghanistan. It has been a truly very, very bloody week in Afghanistan. We have had some of the worst casualty figures, particularly for the Americans. On Wednesday, three Taliban militants attacked a guest house in Kabul. They killed five UN staff, two Afghan security guards and a civilian. 18 American troops also died in action. The US President Barack Obama yesterday took time out to honour the return of some of those soldiers whose bodies were flown back to the United States. So far, this has been the bloodiest month for the Americans, as I mentioned, in the past 8 years. Afghanistan has now claimed 53 American soldiers' lives. And as casualties increase, so American support for the war seems to be dwindling. And it's against that backdrop that President Obama has to decide whether or not he is going to commit a further 40,000 troops to the country. It's a decision he says he won't rush. He says he's going to make it after the second round of voting, which takes place on the 7th of November. That isn't good enough for many, though. The former Vice President Dick Cheney has accused the president of blatant dithering. Now, we had hoped to speak to James Rubin. Unfortunately, there's a fuse and a plug in a far-off country that I can't fix, and so we can't speak to him. But instead, we've got both of you. So, I mean, is this going to be... We've got President Obama, who came into office saying this was the thing that was his priority as far as foreign affairs is concerned. And now we have, well, let me think about it, not 80,000 troops, General McChrystal, maybe 40, but maybe if we have a partnership with somebody else in the region. Is he taking actually a sensible amount of time, or is he dithering?
Well, you know, I'm a Peter Tatzelite on this one. He's the independent Tory MP who's always warned against Afghanistan, said you will never win in Afghanistan, there's no way you can. We could put in 300,000 troops. And a little bit of bad news that emerged today. It turns out that the Independent Election Commission in Afghanistan, which had been told it should reduce the number of polling stations so as to make it easier to prevent fraud, is instead going to increase the number of polling stations. And it looks as if the opposition may well pull out of the vote altogether now. So we might as well hand the whole thing over to the corrupt President Karzai now, without even bothering to have a pretense of a vote, and expect young men and women to go on dying in order to keep him in office. The number of troops you send in is largely irrelevant.
Is it?
I wish it were, but the trouble is the more you send in, the more you get killed. I started off as an Obama skeptic. I wouldn't join in the adulation that this man got. But I have to say his performance over Afghanistan since he came to office has been increasingly impressive. And I was also touched by his appearance at the repatriation of coffins last night, which I think is an act of some political courage, which politicians in this country might consider undertaking. It's time they actually stood and faced the consequences of what they're doing. So I think that his long deliberation over this and his refusal to be bounced by generals is a recognition, at least, that he's learned something from history. He knows, he's read what happened in Vietnam, he's read the way the generals kept on saying, more and more numbers will solve this.
However,
he knows it won't. And there's another very important part of this.
He can't countenance bringing the troops back, though, Peter.
Well, not at the moment, no, but he's the President of the United States. He has to do things more carefully than most of us. You're imprisoned by power as well as enhanced by it. When the Canadians, who were in a very similar position to us, said, right, we've had enough, we can't take any more casualties, our army is completely overstretched, we're leaving. The American response was not anger or disappointment or disapproval, but a quiet nod of understanding from Obama. Again, I think that President Obama is preparing a withdrawal, and I think the continued refusal of politicians in this country to debate withdrawal reflects very badly on them
when it's reached such a high level in the United States. The assumption of him being imprisoned by the office, but yet his heart is dedicated to bringing the troops up, fly in the face of everything that has been said about him and has been said by him. He says this is very important. We just have the stories of the links between the Pakistan Taliban and Al-Qaeda coming out today. So for those who argue that this is actually very, very relevant to what goes on to the streets, they will say, well, look, here's proof positive.
Well, indeed,
we can't come out.
Yes, of course, at the same time, Joe Biden, who is rapidly assuming the same important position in the Obama presidency as Cheney had in the Bush presidency, Biden is warning in his private meetings, we're told, that Pakistan is the real problem. That even if you had a British or American soldier in every acre of Afghanistan, they would simply go increase their strength and their training programs and so on in Pakistan. That's
there is no real border between Afghanistan and Pakistan. It doesn't exist. And okay. the fantasy of the Al Qaeda franchise
is beginning to come back to this subject because it's not going away. Very sadly, it's not going away. But sadly, time is running away.